It looks so cool. I'm wearing a dinosaur shirt.
Oh, yeah.
Okay. That does not suck. You want the blue tongue high five?
Okay.
Oh, jump in. You can go like this.
This one?
I see one! Look!
Yeah!
That's so cool! Hi, American alligator! Oh, I see it!
Oh, Mia, see it as well! Say it again!
How are you doing, American alligator? How are you doing?
Look.
Oh yeah.
Oh yeah.
But there's another one over here.
Oh, see.
Imagine if we could see it fall down. I have no idea.
Cute. What is it, Mia?
They're so cute.
People are throwing chips inside. Those look like chips.
Smiths. They're eating Smiths.
Why are they eating Smiths?
I don't know Smiths.
They're eating Smiths.
No.
Share.
Share this.
Want to have a look at other animals?
What? What's this?
One is swimming. A turtle.
A turtle?
Over here.
Okay.
Blow my mind, baby.
Let it go, let it go. Here we go. Let it go.
How are you doing? Oh, great!
Hey, Jack, do it, honey.
I want to stay all night.
Thank you. family.
For a meal of this size.
What would the dragon there?
I see it.
Died in the night. Ten big dragons have gathered.
What?
Looks very big. Looks like it has lots and lots of scales.
Okay. Oh yes, the tree can go in.
Something. You know the deal. Stop. Really, stop. Now, good afternoon, everybody, and welcome. These are our pet alligators. I normally tell you that they're non-aggressive and they don't try and bite and attack, and that's generally the case, except for one or two little feisty females. Now, you can see the difference in size. The big one, boys, the little ones are mature females. There aren't any babies in this dam. A lot of people think the little ones are juveniles. They're actually adults. Now, the biggest animal here is this one here. You're gonna come and say hello, mate? Come on. Need to hop into the water, buddy. Now, if this is a crocodile, I've been in some very serious trouble being this close to it, but this animal is an alligator. At the end of the day, he doesn't see me as food. He sees me as a protector and a provider of the food. When they come out and chase you, they're not trying to whack you. They're actually wanting you to feed them. Now, we do love our alligators here at the park. A lot of people think we made handbags. We always, can we buy shoes here? And the answer is no. We don't do the leather goods thing at all. We love our alligators. We breed them for display, either here at the park or in other zoos. Now, the Reptile Park made the first import of alligators into Australia in the early 1960s, and some of these big males are from that original import. In captivity, alligators live around about 80 or 90 years. Now, that's about 40 years longer than you would live in the wild. And as a result, the big monsters are always in captivity. You keep growing right throughout your life, and if you've got an extra 40 years up your sleeve in captivity with regular food and all that sort of stuff, you tend to grow to be fairly large. Now, we're always asked about, the most dangerous animal in the dam. Everybody reckons it's going to be one of the big males. But actually, no. If you weigh 400 kilos, you don't really need to throw your weight around very much at all. All you've got to do is get up and walk, and everybody tends to back off. But even our big males give way to one particular female. Her name is Halftail. She's right here at the base of the ramp. She is in charge in this dam. In fact, from this point on, that end of the dam belongs exclusively to her. Now, when she builds a nest, it's a whopper. As you can see over there, it's about twice the size of an average nest. Now, at this time of the year, theoretically, there shouldn't be any females in here. They should all be sitting on their nest and guarding their empty nests. We take the eggs on the day that they are laid, but they think the eggs are still there. So, theoretically, they should be guarding the nests. But they've been living here so long that they trust the staff to the point that they're more than happy to leave a nest, come into the water, have something to eat, and then run back to the nest later. They're so completely non-threatened by the staff. Even Kano standing over there, he's physically large enough to threaten any alligator. But look, there's a nest there, unguarded. That female knows that Kane is harmless and is almost there to protect. Now, Halftail, as usual, there she is right there in her spot. Now, we tie everything onto the ramp. They do have a habit of grabbing stuff out of your hands. We use tongs because if you don't, they have a habit of grabbing your hands. Now, what I'm going to do is fling a bit of food at them. We're not going to feed everyone, but what we'll try and do is feed a few, but try not to get pulped. good is this? Now, I've got a couple of little rats left there, and what we'll do, we'll pop them into a couple of little girls sitting over the back. Now, the next thing we're going to do is a little bit different. Oddly enough, almost as dangerous in a funny sort of way, Tasmanian Devil. Alrighty, thanks, guys. Hope you enjoyed. We'll see you soon. Bye.
So, yeah, it's like medicine for a snake bite.
Damn, Daniel!
Tasmanian Devil.
My ability to care and be on time has diminished, shall we say. Now, in here today, as you can see, I've got a pair of young Tasmanian devils. Now, the Tassie devil is Australia's and the world's largest carnivorous marsupial. Now, these two are siblings, brother and sister. They're about 17 months of age. Now, they won't be sexually mature until they're well into their second year, and by then I'll have them well and truly separated. Now, one might argue that they are from Tasmania, but I'm not quite that desperate to breed them at this stage. Now, when I say the word koala, all animals that carry babies in pouch, they feed the babies milk, and they make that milk by eating all manner of flowering fruit and plant material. But we also have carnivorous marsupials. Now, it's the same basic arrangement. You've got babies in your pouch. You're also cannibalistic. If you're a devil, you're more than content to be chewing away on a roadkill brother. If you're an adult male, one of your skills in life is raiding the dens of other devils, stealing their young and eating them yourself. It's a cheap, easy feed for an adult male. It's expensive. You weren't expecting that, were you? It's expensive for the species as a whole. Now, very sadly, the little devils are disappearing. And this time, it's not diminishing habitat. It's not being shot by naive farmers. The problem for the devil is cancer. And it's not just any cancer either. It's catchable, contagious cancer. There's only three forms of carcinoma that we know of worldwide that are transferable. And very sadly, the little devils own one of them. As I said, this disease has gone from bad to devastatingly worse to catastrophically worse. You see, today, with no cure on the horizon at all, the numbers have fallen from 250,000 to under 15,000. And a fair proportion, you've already had one, don't be doing that. And a fair proportion, you're going to fight me now, aren't you? Don't do it. Don't you do it. Thank you very much. Don't do it. Don't do it. Don't do it. Here, you can have that. Here, hey, have that. Have that. There we go. All right. Now, we have no cure on the horizon at all. So what are we going to do? Well, insurance population is the way to go. Now, what that really means is that we take some theoretically uninfected animals from the wild, we stash them in isolated zoos on the mainland, and we encourage those zoos to breed them quick sticks. When they go extinct in the wild, we then have a safe, disease-free captive population that we can use to reseed Tasmania. Now, this sounds like a marvellous plan, but it's fraught with difficulty and danger. And the problems are that devils can be incredibly, aggressive. Now, you wouldn't know it from these two. These are pussycats, they really are. But an adult male, 10 kilos. Same chompiness as hyena. So having a finger severed by a devil, very, very likely to happen. And of course, if the devil bites off your finger, you can't collect it, have it surgically reattached. He's going to bite it, run away, and eat it right before your very eyes. So, dangerous to work with. The other problems are that devils have a very short life in the big scheme of things. 7 years, that's all you get, mister. 7 years. Mum's got four teats in the pouch and three breeding opportunities in her lifetime. So in a perfect world, 12 young for every mum. Now, the reality is probably under half that in the wild, primarily as a result of predation by adult males. But the biggest issue of all, the devil had never been successfully bred in captivity. It was generally accepted by the zoo fraternity to be... generally thought to be the impossible species. Well, it turns out it's not impossible at all. There is a trick, however. The trick doesn't involve the lab coat or the microscope. It involves space, big spaces. If you could provide 1 hectare per pair, that's 100 metres by 100 metres, or 10,000 square metres, you'd have limited breeding success. But if you could expand that to 6 hectares for each and every pair, well, then they breed all day long, or at least once a year to their maximum potential. But that's the issue. Nobody has sufficient room. I've only got 8 hectares here, we can't do it here. We can't do it at Western Plains or at Taronga. So the only real option is brand new zoo, just for devil. And that's exactly what Devil Ark is. It's part of our Aussie Ark umbrella. Devil Ark is really 500 hectares of land solely devoted to the breeding of Tasmanian devils. Now, when we first started this project, we were told by the zoo fraternity and the government that we were wasting our time and our resources, there'd be zero chance of success. Well, here we are 8 years down the track, and we're now able to provide 100 joeys each and every year. We're in this venture. It's extinction for this species, and I'm really not kidding. This won't be one of those, oh, there's none in the wild, but plenty in zoos. No, none of that. Devil Ark isn't successful, extinction for the devil. And the kids who are here today really will be the very last generation to ever see this species alive. It's a critical mass with numbers. We come in line for a teacup.
Thank you.
우리가 긁어줘. 어, 내가 긁어줄게.
Ranger Mick's been keeping you very well entertained throughout the day thus far. Now, my name's Dan and I'm the head reptile keeper here, and obviously Ranger Mick's inside the yard as well, and I've got Scotty in between the fences there. Now, Ranger Mick's job and Scotty's job today is just simply to back me up, and to be honest, for the next 15 minutes they shouldn't have to do a thing. And if they do get involved in this talk at all during it, then it's probably gone horribly wrong for me. I'd like to think that me and Elvis are the best of friends and we're the best of mates, but it's not really the case. You see, I love him with every bit of my heart, but he hates me with every bit of his. Now, he doesn't just hate me, he hates anyone who comes inside this enclosure, because this is his home, this is his territory, and obviously crocodiles, they will kill for a couple of different reasons. The main reason, they've obviously got to eat, so they'll kill for food, but also too, saltwater crocodiles of the 27 species of crocodilian found throughout the world are by far the most territorial. So right now I'm encroaching on his home, on his territory, and he would love nothing more than forget about the tiny little bits of chicken we've got hanging off the end of the pole there. What he'd much prefer is the big giant turkey in the reptile park uniform. And that's because in the wild, a crocodile as big as Elvis, he's not going to bother chasing little fish or little birds around. What he wants to eat is a medium to large size mammal. So I'm talking about anything the size of an adult kangaroo that might weigh 60 kilos, all the way to a water buffalo that can potentially weigh around 1,000 kilos, and anything in between. So of course, as a human, we don't fit right in the middle of that category, right more, much more towards the kangaroo size, but it does go to show we really are just a walking, talking chicken drumstick to a saltwater croc. But he's saying that, for you to be killed by a crocodile like Elvis, you've got to make a couple of really, really poor decisions if you visit the northern parts of Australia. Obviously, never go swimming where saltwater crocodiles are found. Saltwater crocodiles don't just live in saltwater, but you'll also find them in freshwater. So never take a risk of swimming anywhere where saltwater crocodiles might inhabit. But also too, people stand far too close to the water's edge in croc country. You don't need to do it. Where a crocodile is dangerous is in the water, as I said before, but also in areas close to the water. You see, what they do is they use their tail to strike from the water's edge to grab food items on the edge of the water. So if you stay about, let's say, 7 metres back from the water's edge, you are out of that initial strike range. And I can say that pretty safely because the largest crocodile ever recorded was 6.2 metres long. Saltwater crocodiles can strike about two-thirds of their body length. So if you're 7 metres back from the water's edge, you're out of that initial strike range. Obviously, you're out of the water as well. It's going to be very, very difficult for a saltwater crocodile to come out and grab you. We're land mammals. We're designed to move on land much faster than he ever could. Now, if you visit the top end, please do. It's amazing up there. But please be safe around crocodiles. When people are killed by crocodiles, obviously, it's horrible for the person and their family. But it's also bad for these big fellas as well. Because then people start talking about shooting them and poaching them again. We don't need to do that. We just need to appreciate the fact that they've owned the waterways for a couple of hundred million years. Let them have it. Stay out of the water. Stay back from the water's edge. And I promise you, you'll never be eaten by a large male saltwater crocodile out in the wild. Now, a little bit of story about Elvis himself. He hasn't always lived here at the reptile park. He came here about 10 years ago. We were looking for a big croc, and we come across this big fella. But before he made his way here, he was living in a crocodile farm. Now, if you're a really big, handsome crocodile like Elvis, and you go to a croc farm, you got one job, and that's to make lots of baby crocodiles. But unfortunately for Elvis, he wasn't much of a ladies' man, you see. He actually killed his first girlfriend, and then a year later, he had another girlfriend, and he killed her too. So the crocodile farm very quickly figured out, we've got this big, giant crocodile. He's going to be a killer. We can't really have much use for him, and he's been living here at the reptile park ever since. He's around 4.5 meters long, weighs around 460 kilos, and he really is one impressive croc. All right, let's see how he goes today. So I'm going to send out a few vibrations. We'll get him to come out and hopefully grab the food, and most importantly, not me, but we'll see how he goes. He'll have a little look. Got caught on the carpet there. So he'll drag his feet forward. He'll have a little look at the food. You'll get that tail going at any second. Ooh, like that. All right, come on, big boy. All right, it's yours. There we go. What's that? Yeah. All right, I was getting my breath back for a sec. Check my undies too. Nah, we're all good. So what we were trying to demonstrate there was really the crocodile striking out. That's exactly how they would do it. You could imagine a kangaroo coming down to the water's edge to take a drink, sticking its head in the water, crocodile strikes out, grabs a kangaroo on the head. Most likely that kangaroo is going to be dead instantly, but if not, the crocodile is going to simply sink back into the water, wait for that animal to drown, and then of course they're going to start to eat again. Now we're going to bring him out one more time. We'll try and bring him out a little bit on that side of the pond. Now, one of the sad things about crocodiles, I think so anyway, is people try and paint them out as these mindless killing machines. It's not the case at all. People like to point them out like they're dumb. They're definitely not dumb. They're highly intelligent. Now, their brain is about the same size as your thumb. It's about the same size as most Parramatta supporters. Now, whilst they only have a small brain, they use every bit of theirs. We have a very large brain, and unfortunately, we don't use enough of ours. Now, I even sometimes have people say to me, well, he doesn't really look that big. And you're looking at him in the water. Wait till he comes out of the water. You see, the water refracts his image quite a bit. You lose about 30%. You don't really get a good appreciation for how big a crocodile is until they're out of the water. And trust me, when you're standing as close as we do in front of him, you get a very good appreciation of how big these big fellas can be. All right, we'll bring him up one more time. We're going to come out and grab his chook, and hopefully we'll get to see the crocodile ride out nice and close. And I lost it. I know. Oh, bugger it. I was actually meant to draw him out there, but he was too quick for me and grabbed the food. But anyway, that's how we feed Elvis the crocodile. Give him a round of applause. He did pretty good today. You've got to remember, he's been feeding every single day for the last 6 weeks, and usually we only feed him twice a week. So it's really important that we manage the amount of food he gets, and he's done a wonderful job for the entirety of the holidays, which gives you guys an excellent show every time you come here, besides when I lose the food on the last bit. But anyway, alright, so what we might do now, I've run out of food, so we might have to get Scotty in here with his chicken legs to drag the crocodile out one more time. And we'll get the croc to park about here, and we'll invite one lucky should we do it? Yeah, we'll invite one lucky person the opportunity to come inside here and just have a photo sitting on the base of his tail. So if you'd like to do that, just put your hand up nice and high. We'll try and pick out one person. Let me guess, if your hand is above your head, you're not that bright, you support Parramatta. No. We can't have a photo sitting on Elvis's back, but if you'd like a photo with a crocodilian, you definitely can do that. If you look over your shoulders there, guys, we've got a couple of little hand-raised American alligators, or one hand-raised American alligator. So if you'd like a photo with a gator, head round to the pterodactyl display. It makes for a great little souvenir to take home with you, of course. There's plenty more to see throughout the afternoon.
Come on, baby, just pop it.
That might be a water moccasin.
I think it's a tiger snake.
Where? I think it's a water moccasin.
Can you see it?
I think it's a water moccasin.
Safe to climb up again? I'll try.
Argentinian tegu. Now in captivity, you can very easily, there we go, mate, very easily teach this species to fetch like a dog. You can train them to harness, they'll walk along and call their name. Now we don't bother with any of that sort of jazz here at the park, but this one does have a particular obsession, and that is having his back rubbed. Now, I know it sounds a bit weird if I rub his back. He'll arch himself up to maximize the contact, and he can start rocking backwards and forwards. Now, if you're one of his back rubbers and you recognise as different staff, he'll start doing this in his enclosure as you walk past. And if you don't know what you're looking at, you think, oh my God, he's got epilepsy, he's having a seizure. But no, he's telling you he wants you to rub his back. Now, we do love this character, and I kind of feel a bit sad for him. I imported four of them in 2002. They were already elderly animals on excess species. We brought them in from a zoo in the US. Now, very sadly, all the others have passed. This one is now about 10 years past his theoretically maximum lifespan. Now, I am making another import into Australia. It's really hard for them to see his body outline for the year. Now, the big issue with this species in captivity in the early days is that they really only eat other snakes. And that's the dilemma. All snakes are protected. I can't feed one to another. I can't even take a dead snake off the road and feed it to a live one. It's still illegal. So what do? Well, you manually feed the snake. They can eat mice and rats and birds, they just don't recognise them. So you manually feed it. You take a dead mouse on a long set of tongs, you shove it down the snake's throat. If you do it correctly, good-o. If you do it incorrectly, snake dies. Now, if you've done it correctly half a dozen times, if you're lucky, the snake turns that corner and says, oh, I do quite like to eat mice after all. I will eat a mouse unassisted. Well, that's lovely, Mr. Snake, but now you've grown. Now I need you to eat rats. Now I eat rats, and now I want to eat mice. What do you do? This is what you do. You get a work experience kit and a needle and cotton. And I'm not kidding. You get that kitty to sew the nose of a dead rat to the bum of a dead mouse. Now you've got a mouse rat. Now when you present it to the snake, he goes, oh, mouse, my favourite. The mouse slides down his throat and the rat follows it. You do that half a dozen times, if you're lucky. But that's simply to amuse the senior staff. Now, you can get yourself a black-headed python. It's not the cheapest snake. Bottom-of-the-line snakes, about $150. Black-headed python is shut. Alrighty? No matter what happens, no matter what you see, no matter what happens, don't let it out. Okay? Alright.
Just does that automatically, but that would be very expensive. And here at the Reptile Park, we are notoriously cheap. So sadly, we haven't been able to afford the complex animatronics. Instead, what I've got in here is actually the real thing. Now, and the first thing it sees is you. Now, what I have in here is the Burmese python. Now, this animal is actually only a juvenile. Well, it's not a sort of a baby. When it was in an egg. The egg weighed 140 grams. The snake was as thick as my finger and about that long. We're now about 3.5 years down the track. Now, the female is substantially larger than the male. This animal will end up being around about 100 kilos and 5 meters long. Now, the world record for this species is growing. Now, like most heavy pythons, this one can consume something that weighs 100% of its own body weight. So, parents, look down and estimate the body weight of your toddler. If it's less than 17, it's going down the hatch. So, we've got a winner there. Borderline. Definite winner there. This little one there. You're down the stretch. Another good combination is sort of. That's because I'm asking her to be tame. If I ask her to be wild, then she will appear to be wild. And then if I say, thank you, Rose, that was excellent. As you can see, not wild again. Now all the books say you can't have an alligator like this. Alligators are vicious, cold-blooded killers. They attack, and she knows when to attack. Her now. All right. Is she really that tame? And the answer is yes. Now, all the books say, I should have no fingers for doing that. Well, this animal has lived with me all of her life. She knows who she is. She knows where she is. She's very used to being the centre of attention. Now, you might have seen her on television. She does a lot of radio. If you're a kid, you might have seen her at your school. If you're a teacher or a pushy parent who's always suggesting excellent ideas for the PNC, you can organise to have Rosie at your child's school without the benefit of parental supervision. Now,
see you later, alligator.
Okay, bye.